Today's video is the second in a series where I review a couple of Ambisonics microphones. I have so far reviewed the Voyage Audio Spatial Mic. If you're interested in that review, I'm going to leave a link in the description. And today we will have a look at the Celia ZM1 Ambisonics microphone. This is a third order Ambisonics microphone with a total of 19 capsules, and it has a couple of really interesting features. So let's check it out. Couple of things before we get started. First of all, Celia sent me this mic for review, and I will have to send it back once this video is done. However, they did not have any influence on my review. Everything that I will say is strictly my own opinion, and nobody sees this video before it goes live. Second, in preparation for this video, I had a meeting with Celia. I ran into a few issues when setting up the mic. Going to talk about this a little bit later, but I have to say that the people at Celia were extremely helpful and pointed out a few user errors that I had made. Unfortunately, not everything on their website or in their software is completely clear. If you decide to get that mic, make sure that you read the manual carefully or, like me, ask Celia for help. Third, as mentioned in my review of the Voyage Audio Spatial Mic, I had a student of mine evaluate the different Ambisonics microphones in the field, and I will make a separate video where I will interview her about her experiences in a couple of weeks. If this is something that interests you, please consider subscribing to my channel. In this video, I want to primarily talk about the setup and the overall experience using the Celia mic in a studio environment, and I want to check out if that mic can be used as a regular mic, for example, to make podcast recordings more spatial or three-dimensional. And finally, as I also said in my review of the Voyage Audio Spatial Mic, this is an Ambisonics mic. However, I'm not going to talk about what Ambisonics actually is. If you're interested in finding out more about Ambisonics, I'm going to leave a couple of links in the description. Those point you to some of my previous videos where I talk about Ambisonics, and I recommend that you check that out if this is completely new to you. And with that being said, let's first have a look at the technical specifications and the overall build quality. The ZM1 third order Ambisonics microphone uses 19 omnidirectional condenser microphone capsules based on microelectromechanical systems, or MEMS technology. These capsules have a signal-to-noise ratio of 69 dBA, which is a little noisier than the capsules on the Voyage Audio Spatial Mic, but it is still within the typical range for an Ambisonics mic. Celia sells two versions of the mic. The one that I have here is the basic standalone version that is supposed to be used by itself. And then they also have the ZM1S, which is a version of the mic that has an additional timecode input, and that allows it to be used in microphone arrays for 6 degrees of freedom recording applications. According to the website, there is no hard limit on the number of ZM1S mics that you can connect in an array. Celia says that you can connect up to 20 mics to a single USB port, and then it's a question of how many USB ports your computer system can process. So this is actually pretty powerful. But once again, what I have here is just a single version that cannot be put into an array because it is missing the timecode input. The overall build quality of the mic is pretty good. It looks somewhat unusual, but I think that makes it actually quite attractive. It feels solid and overall a little bit more premium than the Voyage Audio Spatial Mic. There are, however, no connectors on the mic. There's only a micro USB connector that serves for power as well as data. And this is also where I start to have some issues with the mic. Using a micro USB instead of USB-C is, I think, these days an oversight. Additionally, the micro USB connector does not sit very well, and you always have the feeling that it comes off or that you didn't push it in completely. The fact that it receives power through micro USB also seems to be a little bit of a limiting factor. According to Celia, the longest cable connection that you can use is 13 meters or about 40 feet, and that seems unnecessarily short. It should, however, be said that the Celia ZM1 has been on the market for a few years, and when it came out, using micro USB was not necessarily considered a problem. However, these days it is, and I would hope that Celia will change the port to a USB-C port in the next hardware update. The mic also doesn't have a gain control knob, which is also a little bit of a problem since it is a very quiet mic, and I would have wished to have some sort of a manual control knob on the mic sometimes. On the positive side, this is quite an attractive looking mic, and it has a very attractive looking LED ring that gives you some information about the status of the mic. The mic comes with a control panel application that allows you to change the master gain as well as the LED brightness in software, However, one of the issues that I ran into is that the Mac doesn't remember those settings. So whenever I connected it to the computer, I had to reset everything. That was a little bit annoying. And finally, the mic has a little red dot that shows where the front of the mic is. This dot is very small. I realized that this makes for a more attractive looking mic, but I would have sometimes wished that the dot was a little larger because I found myself searching for the dot quite often. So that's all about the tech specs and the build quality. Let's talk about the included software. But before I do that, a quick reminder that if you have enjoyed this video so far, please give it a like and consider subscribing to this channel. If you have any questions or comments, please either use the comment section below or join us on our Discord server. Invite link is in the description as well. I would also like to take this opportunity to give a shout out to our newest awesome channel member, Elaine Champagne. I hope I pronounced that right. Thank you so much for your support. It is truly appreciated. If you want to support this channel like Elaine, you can do that by becoming a member of the channel either through YouTube or Patreon. There's also a free membership option on Patreon if you just want to lurk around. You can also use one of the affiliate links below, or you can buy some of my In Immersion WeFind Presence merch, like this mug for example. Links are in the description as well. All contributions to this channel are used to purchase the soft and hardware I talk about on this channel. And with that being said, let's return to the Cilia ZM1. The Cilia ZM1 is not completely plug and play. There are a few things that you need to install. First of all, you need to install the driver software. Now, this is fairly common on Windows systems, but it's rather unusual on a Mac that you need to install a driver. The people from Cilia told me that this is because they wanted the basic processing done at the system level so that the Mac would be more flexible to be used in applications other than the Cilia plugins. And because of that, you need to install a system extension on a Mac. The problem we ran into with that is that on one of the older Macs we wanted to use, the operating system did not throw the security warning that would have prompted us to allow that system extension to run. And as a result of that, the system extension remained deactivated and the Mac would not do anything when we connected it to that Mac. Annoyingly, we were also thrown off by an unfortunate design choice in the system software. Let me open up the system driver to show you what I mean. So if I open up the Cilia system driver, essentially you see a big activate button here, and we tried to push that activate button, but as it turns out, that is actually not the button. That just indicates that it is activated. The deactivate below is actually the button that you would push if you wanted to deactivate that. So that is a really unfortunate design choice. We could not figure out why this thing would not activate, because we tried to push that button and push it and push and push it. Nothing would happen. But it actually turns out the problem was the system extension that we did not activate. Now, once we knew that, we simply went into the security settings of that system and manually gave permission to the system extension. And after that, everything worked flawlessly. Now, in addition to the driver, you also need the software that can convert the audio from the 19 capsules into a usable signal. And for this purpose, Cilia provides two options. You can either use the Cilia Ambisonics Converter plugin, which converts the signal into a third order ambisonic signal, or alternatively, you can also use the Cilia Studio Pro plugin, which can convert the audio from the 19 capsules into a wide variety of channel-based audio, including layouts such as stereo, binaural, or surround, including 7.1.2 and up to 22.2, as well as any custom layout if you want to create yourself. It's actually fairly powerful. But enough said, let's give the ZM1 a try and check out how it sounds. And for that, I first need to connect the mic to my computer. So I've now put the mic on a mic stand in front of me, and let's plug it in and see what happens. Now, when I plug it in, the first thing that you will see is that the LED ring will turn white, and once it has recognized the microphone, it will turn into blue, and blue now means that it has successfully connected. Now, if it never turns blue, this is what happened with us when we did not enable the system extension, then you have an issue with the connection and you need to check if everything is okay. So it needs to turn blue, and that essentially means that it is being recognized. So let's open up Reaper so that we can receive the signal in our system. And the first thing that we need to do in Reaper is we need to change the settings. So let's go into the settings, and under audio device settings, we need to change this input device to the Cilia ZM1 device. And as soon as I do that, you will see that the LED ring, which is currently blue, will turn to red, and that means that it is now connected to Reaper. Also, make sure that you have whatever output device that you need. In my particular case, I'm using the Rodecaster output device so that you can hear whatever I'm doing here. Then let's add a track that can receive the audio, and for that we are going to add a track here, and this track needs to be a 20-channel track because we have 19 capsules, so we need at least 19, and in Reaper we need to have an even number, so let's make that a 20-channel track. And then we are going to change the input settings to the 20-channel input. And then we are going to turn on monitoring. And as soon as I do that, you see that I am receiving audio signal from the 19 capsules, and everything is now being processed by Reaper. Now, as you can see, the signal is relatively quiet. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into the software application that comes with the Celia Mac, with the Celia control panel, and I'm going to turn up the master gain, and let's turn that up to, let's say, 12 dB. I think that is fine. Once again, here you could also change the LED settings. I'm not going to do that. Then let's go back to Reaper and let's see what we have here. And that sounds, or that looks, a lot better. So now I actually have a usable signal here. Now, with the master gain set to 12 dB, you also see that the microphone is actually quite noisy. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to simply be quiet for a moment, and then you essentially see the noise level here on the meters. So let's just kind of shut up for a second. And I'm actually in a very, very quiet room that is acoustically treated. So this is actually the actual noise that the microphone generates. But let's not worry too much about the noise. We will see that that actually isn't really a big problem. And let's first test it as an Ambisonics mic. And for that, we need to add an Ambisonics converter plugin. And we're going to use the VST3 version for that. So let's go into our track settings and let's add the Celia. Let me just kind of, too many mics in front of me. Celia, here Ambisonics plugin. We're going to use the VST3 version and let's add that. And as soon as I add that, I see the interface coming up. And here I can make a couple of adjustments. I can choose whatever Ambisonics order I want to convert this to, first order, second order, third order. I can change the channel ordering that I want, either Ambix or the previously or the old Fuma ordering. And I can also choose the type of normalization. I can change the position of the microphone from upright to upside down to endfire. And I can also fine tune the position in case I have it kind of tilted a little bit. I can essentially adjust that here. Also make sure that you have the correct settings. In my particular case, I'm using the 3E version of the ZM1. If you have an older version, you can actually kind of change that here. But once again, here I'm using the ZM1 3E. Now, in order to hear something useful, I also need to add an Ambisonics decoder, because right now I'm converting the signal that comes from the 19 capsules into third order Ambisonics. And in order for you guys to hear stereo, I need to decode the Ambisonics signal into stereo. And for that purpose, I'm going to use the Audio Brewers decoder. So let's go into our effect section again and let's change, or let's add the Ambisonics decoder from Audio Brewers. And I'm going to use the VST3 version again. So let's add that. I see the input coming in as third order Ambisonics, and I need to change the output. Now, once again, I want to kind of change that to stereo. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch that over to stereo. I actually am going to switch it over to headphones, which is basically binaural rendering. And now essentially I can use that microphone and you guys can hear what the microphone is capturing. So let's see what we've got. Now, for the following sound test, I'm first going to disable the post-processing on my regular microphone, which is a Luit LCT440 Pure. And then I'm going to switch over to the ZM1 in Ambisonics mode, do an unprocessed sound test, and then finally add post-processing back in and do a processed sound check. So first of all, this is the Luit LCT440 Pure without any processing. This is the Luit 440 Pure going through my Rodecaster. So this is the ZM1 without any post-processing, by converting the signal coming from the 19 capsules into third order Ambisonics and then converting that into binaural with the Audio Brewers decoder. And finally, this is the Celia ZM1 with added post-processing, once again converting the signal from the 19 capsules into Ambisonics and then into binaurals. And similar to what I did with the spatial mic, I can also now talk into your left ear or into your right ear. And somebody wanted to hear how it sounds if I talk from above, so I can also talk from above. Now, the interesting thing here is because the basic processing is done at the system level, you don't necessarily need to use the Cilia plugins. There are other plugins that can also work with the Cilia. You can use, for example, the Sparta Array 2.2.sh plugin and use the Cilia settings. So let's simply do that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to simply delete the Cilia Ambisonics converter. And instead, I'm going to add the Sparta. Where are we? Sparta. Array 2.2.sh, here we are. So I'm going to add that, and obviously I need to kind of switch that in front of the decoder. And in the array 2.2.sh, I simply choose the Cilia settings, and I can do that here. And as soon as I do that, I can essentially also use the Sparta plugin as a kind of converter that converts the signal from the 19 capsules into something that is actually ambisonics. Now, be aware, though, that the Sparta settings seem to indicate that this is for the 1D version of the microphone, whereas I actually here have the 3E version. So depending on the type of microphone that you have, your mileage may vary. It might work or it might not work. For the final sound test, let's now replace the Ambisonics converter with the Cilia Studio Pro plugin. Now, this plugin allows you, as I said before, to convert the signal into pretty much any channel-based audio you need. So let's first delete all the things that we have here. We don't need the converter plugin here, and we don't need the decoder plugin as well. And let's instead add the Cilia Studio Pro. Cilia. And here we have the Cilia Studio Pro plugin, and let's add that instead. The first thing that you will notice is that the plugin says that this is the free version of the plugin. There is also a Pro Premium version, which I honestly think is a little bit too expensive for what it does. The main difference is that in the paid version, you can use this plugin on any third-order ambisonic signal. In the free version, the input has to come directly from the mic. Now, to be perfectly honest, the first time I saw this interface, I was utterly confused. It talks about adding microphones, and I felt, why do I need microphones? I have one microphone and I have only one. And this was actually the first time I really needed to read the manual. What these microphones are supposed to be are the directions from where the sound is being recorded. So the way to think of those is really more in terms of the speakers or the speaker positions that you want to represent in your sound field. So if you're working with 9.1.6, for example, you would have 16 speakers, and each of these speakers would be represented with a microphone here in this interface. Now, the easiest way to set this up is simply use one of the presets that Cilia provides. So what we can do is we can go here into the import section, and what we can do is I have all the presets on my desktop. So let's go into the presets, and here I have a couple of different options that I can choose from. So for example, I could choose the Atmos 9.1.6 preset, and if I open that, I get the entirety of all 16 directions, or all 16 channels. Each channel is represented by a microphone, and each microphone corresponds to one speaker position in the 9.1.6 signal. Now, for each of the microphones, you can now change the output channel where you want to send this to. You can change the separation mode, which is essentially the polar pattern of the microphone. You can change the separation level from medium to high. Be aware that if you change it to high, the processing requirements actually go up quite a bit, so it actually needs a lot of processing power. You can also change the width of the polar pattern, and in order to see how that works, so we can actually kind of enable the view here. So this kind of shows me the polar pattern of the first microphone, that I can change the width here. I can also change the location and everything. Now, the interface also allows me to show an energy map, and this energy map will essentially kind of demonstrate where the audio is coming from. So you see that with the blue ring here, which is actually quite nice. And then also you have an option here to localize the sound. So if you, for example, click on that, it will try to figure out where the sound is coming from, and you see that here. And then there's also a possibility to enable OSC. I'm not completely sure what you would use it for. Essentially, OSC allows you to control all these parameters from or with OSC. Now, you should be able to use that for head tracking. However, because of the way this is set up, you would have to implement that for each speaker individually, and I have honestly not been able to test that. So this might be possible, I simply don't know, but it's a nice feature that you can control the parameters through OSC. Now, one thing that I should mention is that if you change certain settings in one of the microphones, you have to do that for each microphone individually. So if I change one, for example, here, I have only changed the one for the front speaker, and I would need to kind of do the same thing for every single one. So be aware that if you make certain changes, you have to apply them individually to each microphone in that particular setup. So let's switch that over to stereo, and for that I'm going to go back into import, and once again I have that here on my desktop, and you can choose whatever stereo settings work best for you. In my particular case, the wide, stereo wide actually worked best, so I'm going to choose that one, and let's do another sound test. So let's repeat our sound test. Once again, this is the Luit LCD440 Pure without any processing. This is the Luit F440 Pure going through my Rodecaster without any processing. So this is the Celia ZM1 without any post-processing by converting the signals coming from the 19 capsules directly into white stereo using the Celia Studio Pro plugin. And finally, this is the Celia ZM1 Ambisonics microphone with added post-processing, once again converting the signal coming from the 19 capsules into a wide stereo signal using the Celia Studio Pro plugin. And once again, I cannot talk into your left ear or talk into your right ear, or I can also talk from above. So what are my final thoughts on the Celia ZM1? Well, let's start with the not so good stuff. First of all, it is somewhat noisy, especially when compared to the Voyage Audio Spatial Mic. The micro USB connector is honestly a letdown. These days, a mic like this needs a USB-C connector. The software is very good, but it lacks in terms of usability. Be prepared that you have to read through the manual carefully in order to understand the interface, especially of the Celia Studio Pro plugin. The fact that the button in the Celia driver software only looks like a button that actually isn't doing anything is highly confusing, but most people will probably never see that. It only becomes relevant when you're actually troubleshooting something, so this might not be an issue. And if you're on a Mac, be aware that you need to allow the system extension. If you don't get that warning window or miss it, you will need to go into the security settings, enable that manually. And the fact that the control app does not remember master gain, at least it didn't do for me, that is a little bit annoying. On the good side, this is a very attractive and well-built mic, and the results you get out of it are really, really good. So overall, even though I had a couple of issues, I can actually recommend that mic. I think if you are in the market for a mic that can capture higher order ambisonics, you will be very happy with the ZM1. But what are your thoughts? Do you have experience with the Celia ZM1 mic? Do you agree with me? Did I miss anything? Let me know in the comment section below or join us on our Discord server for a chat. Once again, invite link to the Discord is in the description below. And with that being said, see you all at the next video.